जय कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव जय कुंज बिहारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभ जय गिरे जय यशोदानंदन जय ब्रज जन रंजन जय ब्रज जन रंजन जय यमुना तेरा बनचारी जय कुंज बिहारी जय तीरवनचारी जय कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव जय कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव जय कुंज बिहारी
जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोदरक्षि श्रीमद डिवाइन ग्रेस श्रील भय चरणारविंद भक्तवेदांत गोस्वामी महाराज श्रील प्रभुपाद की इस्कॉन विविध संस्थापकाचार्य श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोदरक्षि श्रीमद डिवाइन ग्रेस श्रील भक्त सिद्धांत सरस्वती ठाकुर प्रभुपाद की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की नामाचार्य श्रील हरदास ठाकुर की प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड श्री गिरि गोवर्धन की ब्रजभूमि श्री वृंदावन धाम की पुरुषोत्तम क्षेत्र श्री जगन्नाथपुरी धाम की नवद्वीप मायापुर धाम की गंगा माई जमुना माई की भक्ति देवी तुलसी महारानी की कलयुग पावन हरिनाम संकीर्तन की हरे कृष्ण महामंत्र की श्रील प्रभुपा ट्रांसनल बुक डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन की निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू असेंबल डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्री गुरु एंड श्री गौरांग ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नम ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन् इति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 1 चैप्टर 7 टेक्स्ट 19 चैप्टर एंटाइटल द सन ऑफ द्रोणा पनिश्ड। यदा अशरणम् आत्मानम् ऐक्षत श्रांत वाजिनम् अस्त्रम् ब्रह्म शिरो मेने आत्म त्राणम् द्विजात्मज यदा शरणम् आत्मानम् ऐक्षत श्रांतबाजिनम् अस्त्रम् ब्रह्म शिरो मेने आत्मत्राणम् द्विजात्मज यदा शरणम् आत्मानम् ऐक्षत श्रांतबाजिनम् अस्त्रम् ब्रह्म शिरो मेने आत्मत्राणम् द्विजात्मजः यदा शरणम् आत्मानम् ऐक्षत श्रांतबाजिनम् अस्त्रम् ब्रह्म शिरो मेने आत्मत्राणम् द्विजात्मज जी यदा वेन अशरणम विदाउट बीइंग ऑल्टरनेटिवली प्रोटेक्टेड आत्मानम हिज ओन सेल्फ ऐक्षत सौ श्रांतवाजिनम द हॉर्सेस बीइंग टायर्ड अस्त्रम वेपन ब्रह्म शिरः द टॉप मोस्ट और अल्टीमेट न्यूक्लियर मेने अप्लाइड आत्मत्राणम जस्ट टू सेव हिमसेल्फ द्विजात्मज द सन ऑफ अ ब्राह्मण ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपोर्ट बाय हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस शिला एसी भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी प्रभुपाद When the son of the Brahman, Ashwatthama, saw that his horses were tired, he considered that there was no alternative for protection outside of his using the ultimate weapon, the Brahmastra, nuclear weapon. Purport, in the ultimate issue only, when there is an alternative, the nuclear weapon called the Brahmastra is applied. The word Judatmaja is significant here because Ashwatthama, although the son of Dronacharya, was not exactly a qualified Brahman. The most intelligent man is called Brahmana, and it is not a hereditary title. Ashwatthama was also formerly called the Brahma Bandhu, or the friend of a Brahmana. Being a friend of a Brahmana does not mean that one is a Brahmana by qualification. A friend or son of a Brahmana, when fully qualified, can be called a Brahmana and not otherwise. Since Ashwatthama's decision is immature, he is purposely called herein son of a Brahmana. So this is the seventh chapter of the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And this particular pastime of Ashwatthama being punished is very significant because it reveals that decisions in Krishna consciousness do not automatically happen just because externally Krishna or Krishna's pure devotees are present. People in this world say that you have to work hard. There are those who work hard to make money. There are those who work hard to grow their reputation. There are those who work hard. There are those who work hard to increase their assets, political influence. So Krishna conscious devotees are expected to work hard, to go deeper, to introspect and utilize their intelligence to discriminate what is to be done and what is not to be done, which is favorable to Krishna consciousness. Decision making in Krishna consciousness requires the support of the Lord, the inspiration of the Lord, the reciprocation from the Lord from within. And therefore, in this pastime, we see two very important scenarios. One is, although Arjuna is the closest friend of Krishna, although the Pandavas are the closest devotees of Krishna, still Krishna does not step in to prevent the five sleeping sons of Draupadi from being killed. So Krishna does not prioritize protecting devotees from adversity. Second, when it comes to punishing Ashwatthama, there is a major difference of opinion between Krishna and Bhima on one side and Yudhishthir Maharaj and Draupadi on the other side. And therefore, the Srimad Bhagavatam begins by revealing conflict between top level Vaishnavas on what should be done in a certain situation. So Krishna wants us to expect differences of opinion. Krishna wants us to expect different ways of doing things. And therefore Krishna does not intervene. And he is simply giving various suggestions and expects Arjuna to use his intelligence. And that intelligence is not the material intelligence. It is the spiritual intelligence which is supplied by the Lord when the Lord is pleased. So therefore Krishna wants us basically to work hard to please him. And therefore in the Dhruva Maharaj pastime, when Narad Muni comes to the house of Dhruva Maharaj's father, Uttanapad, at that time he says that your son is doing something which is even difficult for demigods to perform. And Prabhupada writes in the purport, what is the most difficult thing in the entire creation? The most difficult task in the entire creation is to please Krishna. And we have jumped very ambitiously to dedicate our lives to try to perform the most difficult task. That is fine, but we should not expect that the most difficult task will be performed most easily. So that will require a lot of effort. So therefore, through this chapter, Krishna is revealing two things. Expect adversity and expect differences of opinion. But to deal with adversity and to deal with differences, you need to develop absorption. Absorption in serving and pleasing Krishna. And when Krishna is pleased, Dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mami payantiti. And then Krishna reveals to Arjuna what he is supposed to do. And therefore, since this is the month of Damodar Kartik, the similar principle is demonstrated through this beautiful pastime, and where you see Mother Yashoda is binding Krishna. And the theme of the entire pastime is that the task of binding Krishna, of pleasing Krishna, is not easy. It is extremely difficult. It requires repeated efforts. But then ultimately Krishna is pleased with the efforts, and when he is pleased, then he reciprocates. So therefore, it's interesting that this chapter has come again, because I remember in 1994 when I gave my first Srimad Bhagavatam class, it was from one of the verses after this verse, from the same chapter, 7th chapter of 1st canto. So after 27 years, we have come back to 1st canto. Several generations of devotees have heard the Srimad Bhagavatam here in this assembly. And that is Srila Prabhupada's mercy upon us, that he has created a platform by which we can repeatedly hear the Srimad Bhagavatam again and again. Sadyo nashta smritir gopi saro pyaroham atmajam pravardha sneha kalilam hrdayasit yathapura. So the Damodar Lila begins with Krishna eating the mud in the previous chapter, and Yashoda Mai witnessing within Krishna's mouth the entire universe. And by seeing the whole universe, naturally someone would be filled with awe and reverence. But Yashoda Mai, she is so absorbed in her Vatsalya, Pravruddha sneha kalilam hrdayasit yathapura. That love and affection out of great vatsalya arose in her heart again. And so, this is highlighted in the Paribhasha Sutra of the 10th canto in the next verse. Trayacha upanishad bhischa sankhya yogaischa sattvataihi upageyamana mahatmyam harir samanyata putrakaha. So, the Upanishads, all of the different literatures are glorifying Lord Vishnu. But Yashodamai considers Krishna to be her son only. So therefore, in spite of all kinds of provocations to create awe and reverence within the heart of Yashodamai, Yashodamai is totally fixed. And when Maharaj Parikshit is hearing this pastime, Maharaj Parikshit is going to face death in another 3 days. But his heart is fully absorbed in the qualities of Yashoda Mai. And so he is provoked to ask Shukadeva Goswami, Nandah kim akarod brahman shreya eva mahodaya Yashoda cha mahabhaga papavasya hastanam harehe. What kind of activities, austerities, great piety which Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai have created, because of which Krishna became their son like this? Parikshit Maharaj is totally bewildered to hear the glories of Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Mai. So therefore, the question which Parikshit Maharaj asks is, what kind of sadhana did Yashoda Mai do? What kind of sadhana and tapasya did Nanda Maharaj do, because of which they got the opportunity to have Krishna as their son and nourish him like this? So therefore, at that time, Shukadeva Goswami first gives an indirect answer, which is not the real answer. And he says that in the previous lifetime, they were in the form of Drona and Dhara. And as Drona and Dhara, they performed austerities, as a result of which they got the opportunity to have Krishna as their son, as Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda. Why Shukadeva Goswami had to say this? Because he knows that the hearers of Srimad Bhagavatam are in different categories. And therefore, those who believe in the work-reward syndrome must develop some faith that yes, when you perform austerity, you get some benefit. And so, in order to kind of make people's superficial intelligence satisfied, he mentioned this. But he knew that Maharaj Parikshit would not be satisfied with this, and he could sense that. So even without Maharaj Parikshit asking him further, because he could have asked, so many people do austerity. But so many people, in spite of doing austerity, do not get opportunity to see Krishna's Bal Leela, which comes once in a while in so many thousands of cycles of Brahmaji, and only for 11 years Krishna performed pastime in Vrindavan. Why is it that only Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda got that? So therefore, even without Maharaj Parikshit asking, Shukadeva Goswami continues the 9th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the 9th and 10th chapter describe the Damodar Leela. So Krishna appears in this world for 3 secondary reasons. Paritranaya sadhunam, to protect the devotees. Vinashaya dushkritam, to destroy the demons. Dharma sansthapanarthaya, to establish dharma. And the primary reason why he appears is simply to attract the people by his transcendental pastimes. And therefore, tatha paramahamsanam muninam amalatmanam bhakti yoga vidhanartham katham pashyema histriya. The devotees become attracted to Krishna's pastimes, and in the Rasa Leela, in the end, Shukadev Goswami describes, Anugrahaya Bhaktanam Manusham Dehamasthitam Bhajate Tadrishi Krida Yashrutva Tatparo Bhavet. Anugrahaya Bhaktanam. Why Krishna has performed these pastimes in Brajbhumi Vrindavan? In order to demonstrate and display Anugraha, mercy upon his devotees. Manusham Deham Asthitaha. It seems he appears in a human-like form. Athanyadapi Krishnasya toka charitam adbhuta manusham lokam asadhya tata jatim anurundhata. Parikshit Maharaj also wants to hear about Krishna's pastimes in human-like form, apparently in human society, because people can correlate more closely when Krishna appears in human society. And therefore, bhajate tadrishi krida yashrutva. When you hear Krishna's pastimes performed in Brajbhumi Vrindavan, yashrutva, by hearing, tatparo bhavet, one's consciousness becomes purified and attains transcendence. And therefore, Krishna appears in these pastimes, to perform these pastimes. So the question arises that, as Gajendra ji says, na vidyate yasya na janma karma va na nama rupo guna dosha eva va, that yes, the Lord appears in various forms. He does not have any birth, he does not have any name. Apurnasya nija purtharte cheshtaha iti karma. He does not have any karma, he does not have anything to fulfill, because karma means activity performed to fulfill that which is unfulfilled. Apurnasya purtharte cheshtaha. He does not have any of that. But he simply appears to perform pastimes to attract the souls of this world. But then, when he comes and performs pastimes, especially in human society, as apparently a human being, just like when he appears as Lord Rama or Lord Krishna, then only we can, you need a certain kind of comparison to be able to even find fault. It is very difficult to find fault with Narsingdev, because he is so aggressive, and he simply comes and without even giving any introduction rips off Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu could not even ask the question, who are you? And Narsingadev could not answer, who am I? It was done very instantly. And therefore, when Narsingadev appears, it is not something we can relate to and, you know, make some distinction, because he is in another plane. Even from a mundane point of view, if you look at it, half man, half lion, we don't have any previous experience to be able to analyze that. But when Krishna appears as Ram, when Krishna appears as Krishna, then yes, he offers opportunities for us to be able to see, okay, in human society, why did he behave like this? When Sita was kidnapped, while Ram was lamenting like an ordinary person, you know, and Hanumanji also thought like that. Because Hanumanji, when he saw Lord Ram lamenting like that, he was thinking, Are, Mahatma should be equipoised. If Ram is such a Mahatma, why is he lamenting like this as an ordinary person? Ram could see what Hanumanji is thinking. And Ram understood, Hanumanji, Brahmachari cannot understand. And as far as my lamentation is concerned, it is transcendental. He needs to understand first. So therefore, Ram gave his ring to Hanumanji, because he realized certain questions can only be answered with experience, and answers cannot be given before time, unless sufficient effort has been put. And therefore, in Krishna Lila, of course, the number of faults which human society is able to find is unlimitedly more. The number of questions you can raise in front of Krishna. Okay. So someone asked Srila Prabhupada that
Why is Krishna dancing with other men's wives? Prabhupada said, everything in the world belongs to Krishna, including your wife. So therefore, why are you enjoying with Krishna's wives? So therefore, when Krishna performs pastimes and Ram performs pastime, it appears there are faults. So Lord has unlimited good qualities, but human beings, what separates human beings? And when they say mundane, your human beings have 18 faults, principal faults, and within them there are varieties. So one should not think it is limited only to 18. Faults are unlimited, but 18 categories. First, illusion. Second, laziness. Right? So when we hear all this, we can feel a little pacified, because we should know it is part of the design only. It is embedded when Brahmaji has created. Third, error. Then cruelty. Then intense lust, fickleness, arrogance, envy, violence, sorrow, fatigue. Fatigue, right? I can already see many are fatigued. Dishonesty, anger, longing, fear, confusion, partiality, and dependency on others. So these are the 18 principal faults. And as part of their leelas, Ram and Krishna also demonstrated these. Then only they will appear to be playing the part in human society. Right? If Krishna is part of human society and he's a small baby, and when Putana comes, suddenly he develops a nursing roop and kills Putana and again becomes a baby, then people may think, "Arey, this is not human. This is somebody else." So they can't relate. So Krishna maintains all of his features which make him appear part of the human society. So therefore, all of these qualities and the apparent faults in human society are maintained by Ram and Krishna to enhance the emotions as part of the leela. And when we hear from the acharyas, then we actually increase our taste in understanding this. So therefore, the qualities which seem to disqualify Krishna as the Lord are actually wonderful qualities that enhance his greatness. So therefore, he is all attractive. Leela premna priyadikyam madhuryam venu rupayoho iti asadharanam proktam govindascha chatushtayam. So these are the four extra qualities of Krishna, which is rupa madhuri, leela madhuri, venu madhuri, and prema madhuri. So therefore, this Dama Bandhan Leela is a very special and unique pastime. And Shukadeva Goswami describes it in great ecstasy. And primarily, this pastime demonstrates two things. Number one, Krishna wants to highlight, I am controlled by my devotee's love. And second, he wants to demonstrate that Yashodamai and Nanda Maharaj are eternally liberated Nitya Siddha Bhaktas with pure love, with intense quality of their love. And therefore, he is speaking this pastime that Krishna is controlled by his devotees. So Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, before he gives commentary on the Damodar Leela, he makes a comment that, my dear Lord, you bind people in this world under the influence of karma. You bind people who are indulging in anger, in theft, in other low qualities, And by binding them under the laws of karma and punishing them, you make them cry. Now, you involved in theft and anger have been bound by Mother Yashoda and are crying. So, Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur is kind of giving an introduction to this. And so, the first verse describes, as our Satyavrat Muni writes, Namamishwaram Satchidananda Rupam Lasat Kundalam Gokule Brajamanam Yashoda Biyoluka Lavdhavamanam Paramrishtamatyantato Drityugopya. This verse refers to the Mangalacharan. The first line, the first word, Namami, refers to Mangalacharan. Mangalacharan is basically an auspicious invocation addressing the Supreme Lord as the origin of all. And Mangalacharan basically reflects the attitude of bhakti. Namami. So since this pastime is going to contain pastimes of Lord Damodar as the son of Yashoda Mai, one may start thinking that the way Krishna is dealing with Yashoda Mai in this pastime, it is quite similar to how my child also behaves. So one may start mistaking one's own child to be in this situation. So therefore the distinction is made, Ishwaram. So therefore we are talking about Ishwaram, which is Tattva Vishesh. So Tattva Vishesh is described through Ishwaram, which is to invoke the mercy, to empower him to pray. Namami Ishwaram. So Satyavrat Muni is praying, please empower me so that I can describe this pastime. And what are the three characteristics of Ishwaram? First, Ishwaram is Sarva Shaktimanta. He is all powerful. Second, he is Jagadeka Natha. He is the controller of the entire universe. And third, he is Nija Prabhu. He is his own controller. Nobody else can control him. So that is the meaning of Ishwaram. Sarva Shaktimanta, Jagataika Natha and Nija Prabhu. And therefore, now, Namami Ishwaram. What is the Ishwaram like? Satchidananda Rupam. So after Tattva Vishesh, Rupa Vishesh is described. And what does Rupa Vishesh have? Rupa Vishesh has two qualities, Mukhya Gun and Gauna Lakshan. So Mukhya Lakshan means primary, which is, he is the supreme controller. Satchidananda Rupam. He has the form of eternity, bliss and knowledge. But what is the Gauna Rupam? What is the Gauna Lakshan? It is Lasat Kundalam. Krishna Damodar has kundal, earrings, which are swinging to and fro. And therefore, Uddhava, in the second canto, he prays, Yanamartya leelau paikum swayoga maya balam darshayata grihita vismapanam swasya cha saubhagardhe param padam bhushana bhushanangam. He says Krishna's beauty is such that normally ornaments beautify the parts of the body, but Krishna's bodily parts are so attractive that when the ornaments are in touch with Krishna's bodily parts, one refers to the ornaments and one glorifies the ornament, that, oh, you are so fortunate that you are ornamented by Krishna's ear. Because Krishna's ear lobes are more beautiful than the ornament. And that is known as Lasata Kundalam. And so, this is Saundarya or Rupa Vishesh. And then, Parivara Vishesh. Krishna is not alone. Krishna has his beauty. But apart from his beauty, Krishna has his beauty in his relationships with his devotees. Gokule Brajamanam. So, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami describing Krishna entering into Gokul with his cowherd boys, has penned a very beautiful verse, and he says, Gokulair Gokulam Ninye, Gokulam Gokulair Haran, Gokulam Gokulastrinam, Gokulair Gokuleshwara. So Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami, who was Kaviraj, was the best amongst poets. He has written this verse. He says, Gokulair Gokulam Ninye. When the Lord of Gokul, Gokulam Ninye, Gokulam Gokulair Haram. When the Lord of Gokul drove his Gokul, drove or chased or pushed his, you know, group of cows. So the group of cows is also known as Gokul. When the Lord of Gokul drove the group of his cows, Gokul, into Gokul, as he entered into Gokul, and as he entered into Gokul, what did he do? Gokulam Gokulair Haran. He stole the senses, the group of senses, Gokul, of whom? Gokulastriyam, of the young girls of Gokul, and Gokulair Gokuleshwara, and the eyes of the people of Gokul. So this is what is known as Parivara Vishesh, where Krishna is surrounded by his associates in Brajabhumi Vrindavan. And then Leela Vishesh, in the last two lines he describes, Lasat Kundalam Gokule Brajamanam, Yashoda Bhiyolukhalavdhavamanam, Paramrishtam Atyantato Drutya Gropya. So therefore, Paramrishtam describes the super excellence of Yashoda Mai's beauty and how Yashoda Mai was running behind Ulukhalat as Krishna was running with the mortar, Dhavamanam, from the mortar away, but she was also running very swiftly. Atyantato Drutya. So now we will describe this particular two lines. Yashoda Bhiyolukalav Dhavamanam Paramrishtam Atyantato Drutya Gopya. In the ninth chapter, first and second verse, Shukadev Goswami describes, Ekada Grihadashishu Yashoda Ananda Gehini Karamantara Niyuktasu Nirmamantha Swayam Dadhi. Ekada, one day. So da means time. Yada means at some time. Kada means at which time. Sada means at all times. Ekada means one day. So what was that day? It was the day which was on Deepavali and just a day before what we now celebrate as Govardhan Puja. But that time, Govardhan Puja had not yet happened because Krishna had not yet confronted Indra. Krishna had his own phase-wise plan when he would do different pastimes. So therefore, Indra Puja was still going on. And Krishna was seeing all of that for several years. It was not that Krishna on that day, when he asked Indra, when he asked Nanda Maharaj, what is this you are doing? For 6 years he was seeing every year what was going on. So many times Krishna will keep seeing. But when he decides to question and put an end, then nobody can stop that. So therefore Indra Puja preparation was going on. And Griha Dasishu, all of the, you know, maid servants of Yashoda Mai were involved in making all kinds of items for that particular puja, the day before Indra Puja. So, on that particular day, on Diwali day, Rohini and Balramji had been invited by Upananda. So why is this detail important? Because Krishna was convinced that if Rohini was there that day, she would have intervened and stopped Yashoda Mai from doing this. So therefore, Rohini and Balram were not there. And so it is described here, Griha Dasishu, Yashoda, Nanda, Gehini, Karamantara, Nyuktasu, Nirmamanta Swayam. So Nirmamanta Swayam means what? Nirmamanta Swayam means four things. First, Swayam, Yashoda Mai was doing because she had great love for Krishna. Second, she felt her tasty butter would stop Krishna from stealing in other homes. Third, Yashoda Mai felt, I will personally churn and then offer this butter to Lord Narayana and then pray for Krishna's protection. And fourth, Yashoda Mai is the giver of fame. So she was going to give that fame to Krishna, that Krishna is Bhakta Vatsal, controlled by his devotees. And why it was early in the morning? Because Yashoda Mai, just like in many homes also, when the children are there, you know, the parents plan to do things when the children are not going to be disturbing. So Yashoda Mai also planned so that Krishna will not disturb. And this milk from which the yogurt was made, which she was churning, was from the rare Padmagandha cows. Okay. Rare as a horse with one black ear and eating the most fragrant grass. So out of 9 lakh cows, only 7 or 8 like that were there. And therefore, Chakravarti Pad adds one more point. Yashoda Mai was thinking, why she did not give it to the servants? Yashoda Mai was thinking, how can the servants who keep burning the milk, how can they do justice to this? You know. So, Nirmamantha Swayam refers to the fact that there are certain things in bhakti which we cannot outsource to others. There are things which we can, while doing seva in the mission, we have to delegate. You do this, you do this, you do this. You distribute prasadam. You know, you distribute the books, you do this. You can't say, now you chant my 8 rounds. Can you go and attend Bhagavatam class on my behalf? Here is Bhagavatam. Please read every day 1 hour for me. So, there is a limit to how much you can delegate. Right? I remember when I was, when I joined the ashram, my family organized a program for me in Chennai. And I had gone with one more devotee with me and all the relatives were there. And then this devotee, he mentioned that because, you know, your relative has joined Krishna consciousness movement, is chanting the holy names and everything, 21 generations will be liberated. So everybody started clapping. And after the lecture, one of my cousins came to me and said, please continue chanting. Don't stop. Continue your bhakti. If there is any problem, let me know. So he got convinced that by my doing bhakti, he's going to get benefited. But when we are aspiring for prema, that does not work. So Nirmamantha Swayam, Yashoda Mai herself, and Chakravarti Pad describes, she was driven by a stubbornness arising from Vatsalya Prema. Which shows one of the inherent, you know, skill sets needed to advance in bhakti is stubbornness. Hut. Unless there is above average level of stubbornness, you cannot practice bhakti. How can you say no meat eating, no intoxication, no onion, no garlic, no chai, no coffee, No paan, no paan parag. All of that needs stubbornness, is it not? To come regularly to the temple. We have gone to so many temples in the past. Most of us, even before coming to ISKCON, have gone to so many temples. Right? Nobody had any much problem with our going to temples. But when you start coming to the ISKCON temple, then people start questioning, why you are going? Why you are going to the ISKCON temple? Why? Because they know, ISKCON temple means yad gatva na nivartante. Once gone, a person turns back totally transformed, changed. Habits change. Right? So therefore, yes, it requires certain degree of stubbornness. And because by default, vyavasayatmika buddhi ekeha, that requires some stubbornness. So we have to understand that while dealing with devotees and trying to organize devotees and trying to manage devotees also, we should know that that is an ornament, the stubbornness. And therefore, we have to deal appropriately and accordingly and expect things accordingly. And so, she was churning the best yogurt. And she churned the yogurt with nirmamantha. So the word ni is added to mamantha. Mamantha is to churn. Why ni? Ni refers to certainty. She had a certain, she had a degree of certainty. Yes, I will be successful in making the butter for Krishna. She was very focused. She knew what she was doing. So therefore, that churning was not done in a lackadaisical manner, casual manner, in a confused manner. You know, not knowing whether I should do or not do. Is it too much for me? Should I give it to the servants? How long should I continue? Nirmamantha means she was churning with extreme certainty, determination, focus, absorption. And therefore, it was impossible that she would alone churn the excellent milk. Okay. Now, grihadasishu. So, grihadasishu means all of the karmantara niyuktasu. The servants were engaged in other activities connected with Indra Puja. So then it is described here. Yani yani ha gitani tad bala charitani cha. Dadhi nirmanthane kale smaranti tani agayata. As she was churning, Yashoda Mai was engaging all of her senses perfectly in Krishna's service. So Yashoda Mai is an embodiment of how one should serve. Her body was engaged, her hands were churning. So body was engaged totally. Dadhi nirmanthane. So hands were engaged. Her tongue was engaged. Right? Yani yani ha gitani tad bala charitani. She had composed verses from Krishna's pastimes and her tongue was engaged in glorifying Krishna. And therefore, she was singing and engaging her tongue. And then she was engaging her mind, smaranti, remembering those pastimes of Krishna. And then as she was singing and remembering, she was hearing. So she was singing, hearing, remembering, and at the same time, doing what she was praying for and aspiring. So therefore, one's actions, one's words, one's hearing, and one's remembrance should all be totally focused in serving Krishna. So therefore, she did this to remember Krishna and to pacify her longing in separation from Krishna because Krishna was in another room and he was sleeping. And so Yashoda Mai's beautiful yellowish complexion, the complexion of her dress is described in the next verse. How her eyebrows moved expressively, reflecting her happiness. Her bracelets were moving and her body color was darkish, and she had her waist cloth and beads of perspiration as she was churning vigorously parishram, doing for Krishna with her tongue, with her ears, with her mind. So therefore, this is the state of a perfect devotee, fully engaging body, mind and intelligence in Krishna's service. And so, anybody who is aspiring to serve Krishna in the mood of Vatsalya must meditate on Yashoda Mai like this. And it is described by Srila Jiva Goswami in Krama Deepika that she had a blackish complexion, and in Gautamiya Tantra she is described as having yellowish complexion. And the beauty of her natural movement, she pulled the ropes and her earrings swayed. And her hair were tied by jasmine flowers, because jasmine flowers grow during the month of Kartik profusely. And as she was churning, because of affection for Krishna, milk was coming out from her breasts continuously. And as she was singing Krishna's pastimes, her body was moving to and fro. And the joy was expressed by the movements of her eyebrows as she was glorifying Krishna. So now Krishna, who was sleeping in the next room, heard Yashoda Mai's singing. And he got up. Krishna just got up. He had not yet met his friends. He got up. And as soon as he got up, he became hungry. And he comes to Mother Yashoda crying. Tam stanya kama asadya matnatim jananim hari grihitam dadimanthanam nyashedhat pritimavahan. So stanya kamam, so Krishna is very hungry. He wants to have the milk of Mother Yashoda. But he comes and places his hand on the churning rod. And Nyashedhat, he stops her. Matnatim Jananim Dadimanthanam. Why Krishna stops Yashoda Mai from churning? The churning is described as that of studying and analyzing various scriptures to come to the conclusion. So Krishna is trying to tell Mother Yashoda, the conclusion of all the scriptures is standing in front of you. What further churning is required? I am right here. Vedeshya Sarvair Aham Eva Vedyo. Therefore, Yashoda Mai, she was in perfect bliss. She attained Avahan happiness because of three reasons. First, she was pleased with Krishna's intention, that Krishna is expressing intention to reciprocate with her. Second, she could also see that Krishna is forcibly stopping her. So Krishna is demonstrating his intensity. And third, Krishna is using his intelligence by putting his hand right there and stopping that churning from happening. So Yashoda Mai is very pleased that Krishna is growing, and her nourishment of Krishna is actually very successful. And in this way, Yashoda Pritim Avahan, it is described, she was in great bliss, great joy by seeing Krishna reciprocate. And one word used here is Matnatim Jananim Hari. So Hari means one who is most attractive. So Krishna in this mood, trying to stomp Yashoda Mai, is looking extremely attractive. So now the question arises that Krishna woke up hungry. Why? Because he woke up earlier than usual. And as soon as he got up, the first thought in his mind was, where is Mother Yashoda? Are, she is not worried about me. I am so hungry. She is not giving attention to me. She is doing some household duties. And therefore, because of that hunger, he was already feeling some degree of anger. And so rubbing his eyes, he was crying and running to Mother Yashoda when he heard that sound. And therefore, the question arises, how can Parabrahma Atmaram be hungry? He was hungry for Yashoda Mai's love. And to indicate his desire for that milk, Krishna did two things. He was sobbing and crying, and he stopped that churning with his hand. So then, at this point, Yashoda Mai stopped that churning and took Krishna upon her own lap and started offering her milk to Krishna. Tamankamarodam apayayat stanam snehasnutam sasmitam ikshati mukham. And as Yashoda Mai was offering her milk to Krishna, she was seeing Krishna's beautiful face as he was drinking her milk. And as the extra milk was flowing out, Krishna's beautiful bluish complexion face, surrounded by the white milk flowing out, appeared so beautiful. Atriptam utsrijja javena sayayau utsichyamane payasitu adhishrite. And Krishna had unlimited appetite for drinking Yashoda Mai's milk. Yashoda Mai had unlimited appetite for feeding Krishna. And as this was going on, it is described here that Yashoda Mai's lap is Krishna's property, tamankam. Before even Yashoda Mai picked up, Krishna jumped on Yashoda Mai's lap because Krishna felt, this is my property. I don't need an invitation. And Krishna became proud that I have managed to stop her. I also got some strength now. And so there was this competition. So it is described that as Yashoda Mai was feeding Krishna, Krishna was just like the Chataka bird waiting for the rain to come. Krishna was waiting for Yashoda Mai's milk and overflowing from his cheeks. And at this point, Yashoda Mai was completely dissatisfied because she had unlimited appetite to feed Krishna. Krishna was also not satisfied because he had unlimited desire to drink from Yashoda Mai. But at that time, it is described that Yashoda Mai observed that the milk kept on the stove started boiling over. It was coming over. And as that milk started coming up, Yashoda Mai was in a dilemma. What she should do? So Yashoda Mai at that time left Krishna on the ground and ran towards that fire. So the question arises, if the milk was overflowing from the stove, Yashoda Mai could have carried Krishna with her. Why Yashoda Mai did not carry Krishna? There were two reasons. First, Yashoda Mai had to move extremely fast, and there was no time for carrying Krishna. And second, Yashoda Mai felt, if I carry Krishna with me and run, I may drop Krishna. So therefore, considering both, Yashoda Mai kept Krishna down. So the question arises, how can Yashoda Mai leave Krishna to save a little milk, depriving him of her milk? So the acharyas explained that Yashoda Mai is the epitome of Vatsalya Ras. Her love for Krishna has no limits. So in the Gopal Champu, Brahmaji you know, is quoted that, you know, Krishna gives everything to anybody who even approaches a little bit. Just like Putana came dressed as a devotee, she was given position of mother. So therefore Krishna, he can actually, sadveshat eva putana pisakula tvam eva deva pisa yad dhamartha suhrit priyatmataneya pranashayas tvatkrite. So what to speak of Brajavasis who had given up everything for Krishna. The second, so Yashodamai is the epitome example of Vatsalya. So her love for Krishna cannot be questioned. Second, there was a higher principle that service to Krishna is non-different from Krishna. And so the special milk from Padmagandha cows had to be protected. Third, since that milk was for Krishna, it was more attractive than Krishna. So therefore, because Yashodamai made Krishna the object of her compassion, it was her duty to serve Krishna. And so the question arises, if you compare Yashodamai with Chandura and Mushtika, while fighting Chandura and Mushtika, Krishna experienced great joy. But then Yashodamai made Krishna cry. But then there is no comparison, because Yashodamai's reciprocation with Krishna was anukulena Krishna anushilanam. It was for pleasing Krishna. It was anukul. So therefore, it is described here that Yashodamai, while she kept Krishna on the ground, she offered her prayers to Krishna that you are worshipable for me, my dear Krishna. I would worship you with an aarti, but at this moment I have to leave you because I have to take care of that milk so that not even a single drop falls over, and I will come back to you instantly. So therefore, Jiva Goswami describes that the wealth of the cowherd community is the milk and milk products. And Yashodamai was thinking, this wealth, this milk belongs to Krishna. My child is helpless. He cannot take care of this wealth. I have to take care of his wealth on his behalf. So Yashodamai ran towards that milk on behalf of Krishna. And so Prabhupada makes his famous purport. Sometimes one must take care of more than one item of important business for the same purpose. Therefore, Yashodamai was not unjust when she left Krishna to take care of that overflowing milk. So Prabhupada mentions in his purport, on the platform of love and affection, it is the duty of the devotees to take care of one thing first and other things later. The proper intuition by which one can do this is given by Krishna. Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadame buddhi yogam tam. That intuition is given by Krishna, what to do when. So therefore everything is dynamic, and Krishna guides the devotees in what to do first and what to do next on the platform of absolute truth. So therefore, this is very, very important point, that Yashodamai was in a dilemma, and Krishna conscious service will always be filled with some kind of a dilemma, but Krishna gives the intelligence from within. And therefore in the association of devotees we must always respond to situations and not react, because if we react in a way which is displeasing to the devotees' displeasure will result in Krishna's displeasure, and he will stop giving us that spiritual intelligence. Dadami buddhi yogam. So the greatest loss in the association of devotees is the loss of access to the intelligence given by Krishna. At no cost, we should lose access to that spiritual intuitive intelligence which comes from Krishna's pleasure. So therefore, Yashodamai was given that intelligence from within. So why she did not go while feeding and holding him? Number one, speed. There was only a moment. Third, she had the highest love for Krishna. And why Vatsalya? Because she wanted to also teach responsibility. That yes, anything connected to Krishna needs to be taken care with responsibility. She was totally selfless. She wanted to protect that milk for Krishna's sake. And in this way, Yashoda Mai ran towards that milk. So now the question arises about the milk itself. Why was that milk overflowing into the fire? Externally, it was because of the heat. Internally, the milk was thinking, Yashoda Mai is pleasing Krishna. Krishna is pleased with Yashoda Mai. Yashoda Mai has unlimited capacity to feed Krishna milk. Krishna has unlimited capacity to drink milk of Yashoda Mai. Both are so much in bliss with each other's service and reciprocation. When will this end? And if that does not end, what is the use of my getting boiled? I will not be used in Krishna's service. So therefore, because the milk is also a person, he decided, let me end my life by jumping into the fire. And so, everything in the spiritual world is alive and conscious. And, you know, Prabhupada tells a story. How does Yashoda Mai, while cooking rice for Krishna, know that the rice is cooked? Yashoda Mai is serving Krishna in one room, dressing Krishna. The rice is getting cooked in the kitchen. And when Yashoda Mai wants to find out whether the rice is cooked or not, what she does? She shouts to the rice, "Are you cooked?" And then the rice, being a personality, responds, "Some more time." And then Yashoda Mai gets to understand that. Like that. So one devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, he was a kind of a scholar, and he said, "Srila Prabhupada, when we chant Krishna, Hare Krishna, different devotees chant Krishna's name differently. Someone says Krishna, someone says Krishna, someone says Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. So what is the right way?" Prabhupada said, "Don't worry, Krishna knows you are calling him. That is more important. Your intention is most important." So now Yashoda Mai, you know, runs to take that milk out. And when Yashoda Mai has gone to take the milk off the stove, Krishna is thinking, "I have left the ocean of milk and taken avatar in this world. I have given up the ocean of milk to come to Gokul, and she is running behind 1 liter milk. This is my value here in this home." So Yashoda Mai's action angered Krishna. Sanjata kopas purita runadharam sandasya dadbhir dadimanta bhajanaihi bhitva mrishashrur drishadashmanaraho jahasahayangavam antaram gata. So Krishna is anger, in angry mood. Sanjata kopa, very angry. Spuritarunadharam, his lips were reddish and swollen. Sandasya dadbhir, he had placed his white teeth over his red lips in anger. Also indicating that mode of goodness can only control mode of passion. Dadi mantha bhajanam bhitva. Okay. The white moons of his teeth became red like his lips and his eyes, like chakora birds. And his eyes became filled with tears that I have been rejected, I have been neglected. So Krishna at that time took his two lotus hands and then he took his took one small piece of stone and then he thought, I have limited strength, but I must, you know, inflict maximum damage. How with little strength I can inflict maximum damage? He started thinking and he thought, if I make a hole at the bottom of the pot, all the contents will go out. So Krishna took the piece of stone and aiming right at the bottom, he hit. The pot broke and the contents started flowing out. Krishna was satisfied. Mission accomplished. And then immediately he became fearful and ran to the next room. So therefore, he was deprived of his mother's milk. Also, Krishna wanted to make a point that when someone is being fed, suddenly to drop that person, you know, that is also lack of empathy. So he wanted to make this statement that, you know, I am extremely angry that I have been suddenly abandoned like this. And why he became angry? To reciprocate with and to please Yashoda Mai in due course of time. And this was, it is described here, his Bhitva Mrisha Ashru. These were real tears, not false tears. Amrisha Ashru, genuine tears. Sometimes, you know, when the Pandavas died in Mahabharata and all, Krishna also cried, but those were false tears. So sometimes Krishna fakes crying, but today his crying was real, Amrisha. Why? He was actually unsatisfied and dissatisfied. So here we find Parabrahma, who is Apta Kama, he becomes dissatisfied. Okay. And so, when a child becomes angry, he begins crying. Now Krishna breaks the pot and then he goes to the next room and starts eating, as it is described, old butter. Hayyam jahasa hayyangavam. Hayyangavam means butter which is slightly old. And Krishna started feeding the monkeys also. He wanted to rebel. And at this point, Yashoda Mai came and she saw that the pot is broken. And, you know, she was thinking, how cleverly Krishna has broken the pot right at the bottom. So, in that mischief also, Yashoda Mai felt some pride. My son is so intelligent. He knows exactly where to create damage. So he's so intelligent. So she started laughing. And then, you know, she was thinking at this point, only Krishna can have this skill to do this. He's such a fickle person. He has run out of fear. And then she started hearing the sound in other room. And she started feeling afraid that I have trained him so much, but still he is so impudent. What is going to happen in the future? And at that point, an Akashvani came from the sky and spoke to Yashoda Mai. That, oh Yashoda Mai, the thirsty baby bee, not fully satisfied with the honey, broke the lotus bud. Saw only the contents flowing but no honey, went to another lotus. You showed the skill of saving milk, but now we want to see your skill of pacifying your son's anger. So this was an Akashvani which came from the sky. And Yashoda Mai smiled and she followed Krishna's butter footprints. And as she heard Krishna's ankle bells. And at that time when Krishna was looking around in fear, he could see Yashoda Mai entering. Because what Krishna saw was right in front of Krishna, they were the monkeys who were sitting and peacefully eating the butter. And as they were eating the butter, Krishna had his back towards Yashoda Mai as she entered. So Krishna did not see Yashoda Mai. But the monkeys were facing Krishna. So the monkeys saw Yashoda Mai with the stick. Their eyes went
big.
When Krishna saw the monkey's eyes growing big, Krishna realized something is wrong. He turned around, saw Yashoda Mai, and then she saw a form of Yashoda Mai he had never seen before. Yashoda Mai with a stick. When previously all the Brajavasis would complain to Yashoda Mai that Krishna has stolen butter, she would always defend Krishna. This was the first time she had taken upon herself to punish Krishna. So therefore, prasamiksha means Krishna scrutinized every move. And so Krishna thought, I have limited time. I have to do something so that I escape from Yashoda Mai. So he thought, generally speaking, parents or anybody is afraid to punish others in public. So if I am inside the house, she will punish me. Let me run fast, so that I come right in the courtyard in front of everybody. When all the other Brajavasis and other gopis are there, because of public shame, she may not punish. And at the same time, other people will also have sympathy for me. So very strategically, Krishna started running. So the purpose of his running was to go in a public place, so that he would get support and Yashoda Mai will not punish. So apasasara bhitava, he began to flee with great fear. So gopyanvadhaban nayamapayoginam kshamam praveshtum tapaseritum manaha. Kshamam praveshtum tapaseritum. Greatest yogis, after performing austerities, cannot attain that lotus feet of Krishna. So at this point, Krishna's fearful running and Yashoda Mai's chasing is described. Okay. So, yogis cannot reach Krishna, but for a mother Yashoda, Krishna is caught. Madbhayad vati bhatoyam suryastapati madbhayad. Greatest demigods are afraid of Krishna. Krishna was afraid of mother Yashoda. Bhitavat, as if having fear. So there was affection, so no fear, and fled in a fearful manner, showed his fear towards others. So Yashoda Mai's fortune cannot be understood, because it was a greater fortune than all the others, because she was getting to chase Krishna and hold Krishna and feed Krishna upon her lap. So therefore, she had the greater fortune than all the others put together. And as Yashoda Mai is running, the malati flowers from her hair started falling on the ground, because the malati flowers saw this scene, that yogis chase the absolute truth. But now the absolute truth is running away out of fear of Mother Yashoda. Who is this great personality, Mother Yashoda? Rather than being on her head, we should be on her feet. So they jumped to try to touch Yashoda Mai's lotus feet. So while chasing, Yashoda Mai was shouting at Krishna, "O king of thieves, where are you going?" Krishna was fearfully looking behind, over his shoulder, now and then, looking at Yashoda Mai, how far behind she is. Because when you are running, you have to see, to be able to estimate how much more effort to put. So Yashoda Mai was feeling fatigued. Her body, arms and legs were looking beautiful as she pursued Krishna, who was mischievous. And she was full of anger. Yashoda Mai continued shouting to Krishna, "Stop! Krishna, you thief, you liar! How can you carry on like this? Where are you going? Just stop running." Just stop running and stand where you are. Yashodamai was shouting at Krishna like this. And Krishna also was no less. He kept shouting back as he was running. Yes, I will stop if you drop the stick. You drop the stick, I will stop. He was negotiating. So then, you know, Krishna, he would run at a distance, stop, turn around, and give this dialogue to Mother Yashoda. You drop the stick and I stop running. But Mother Yashoda would continue running with the stick, Krishna continued running. And Yashoda Mai said, if you are so afraid of being punished, why did you break the pot today? Krishna said, I will never do it again. You just drop the stick. So Krishna wanted to come to a conclusion. Whatever is done. Come to the point. Let's negotiate to conclusion. Let's not analyze the past. Let's look at the present. So Yashoda Mai's mind turned into amazement. But seeing her angry mood, Krishna quickly ran away. Mother, please drop that stick. Don't punish me. After hearing Krishna's innocent appeal, Yashoda Mai dropped that stick. So Krishna also stopped running. So therefore, all the denizens of the heavenly planets were amazed to see this. And one of the personalities who were witnessing and getting bewildered was Brahmaji. That, this is the absolute truth. He's crying, he's negotiating, he's pleading. What is going on? So Yashoda Mai's hairs was, you know, falling apart, and the face appeared totally exhausted. So as, you know, Yashoda Mai came near Krishna and Krishna tried to run away, she held Krishna's hand. And at that time, Krishna spoke to Yashoda Mai, please do not beat me. He rubbed his eyes like that. So, it is described here that, you know, Yashoda Mai was chastising Krishna as she was running. Oh, restless boy! Oh, hot-tempered boy! Oh, greedy boy! Oh, lover of monkeys! Oh, plunderer of the house! I will no longer give any more milk products for you. I will bind you so that you can no longer play with your playmates, with your friends. You cannot go to the forest. You will just stay here. So Yashoda Mai, it is described, had the fortune of catching Krishna, who cannot be caught by the yogis, of chastising Krishna, who is glorified by Brahma and Shiva also. And she threatened Krishna just by raising the stick. And Krishna became fearful, that Krishna who makes even the Yamaraj fearful. And therefore, Krishna at this particular point, you know, pleaded, please do not punish me. And so Yashoda Mai said, if you are so afraid, why did you break the pot? So at this point, Yashoda Mai was very fearful. For what? That my son is not getting trained and not getting disciplined. Second, he may run to the forest. And therefore, Yashoda Mai wanted to make sure that Krishna is safe. And so, she decides that I will bind Krishna. So therefore, as soon as Yashoda Mai catches Krishna, a conversation begins. Right? And what is the conversation? Yashoda Mai tells Krishna, your father's lineage is all thieves. Krishna is telling Yashoda Mai. So Yashoda Mai says, how did the yogurt pot break? Krishna says, the yogurt pot, you know, the Supreme Lord used some stick. And by using that stick, it broke. I am not responsible. I am innocent. Then Yashoda Mai looks at him and says, who gave butter to the monkeys? Krishna says, one who created the monkeys. After scolding him as a thief, her heart softened. Yashoda Mai says, give up your pride and tell the truth. When you ran quickly, the pot was struck by your anklets. Krishna is telling, it is not me who broke. You were running. You didn't even see. Your anklets broke that pot. And then, inspired by the Supreme Lord, the monkeys entered the room. Inspired by the Supreme Lord, they took the butter. You broke the pot. The monkeys on their own ate the butter. Why are you accusing me? I am not in the picture at all. Seeing you with the stick, Yashoda Mai said, then why did you run? Why you are running? Sir, if I see you with the stick, what else I will do? So therefore I ran like a thief. Where is my fault? And then you are seeing that I am afraid, and by seeing I am afraid, you are threatening me that I will beat you. So therefore, this is not justice. O best of thieves with clever words, Yashoda Mai says, you are the son of the king of Vraja. You not only are fond of monkeys, you have nature of monkeys also. So then Krishna made a statement. In that case, I will leave your home and go and stay with the monkeys in the forest. When Yashoda Mai heard this, that gave her anxiety. That, he will leave and go to the forest and stay with the monkeys. So I should stop him from going. So therefore she decided, let me bring the rope. So she brought one of the softest ropes and tried to bind Krishna. So when she tried to bind Krishna with that rope, what happened? That rope was 2 fingers short. Krishna's waist was only this much. But Yashoda Mai could not bind with that large rope. So she brought one more rope and tied to it. Even that could not bind Krishna. All the ropes in the house she exhausted. By then all the other gopis came. And they saw this pastime and it became the fun pastime in Vrindavan. That what is going on today? Krishna is not getting bound. So therefore, it is described that as Yashoda Mai was trying to bind Krishna, Rudantam Muhur Netra Yugmam Mrajantam Karambhoja Yugumena Sa Atanka Netram. So Krishna's eyes are filled with fear. Muhushwasa Kampatri Rekhanka Kantha Stita Graiva Damodaram Bhakti Bhattam. So as Krishna is crying, the cry of Krishna is something astonishing, because simply by his smile, that personality can take away the miseries of this entire universe. Hasam harer avanatakhila lokativra shokashu sagara vishoshanamatyudaram. That Krishna is standing there crying, right? And Krishna is indicating to all the devotees, you are coming to me with tears in your eyes, praying to me, please remove my tears. Look at me. I myself crying. So therefore, at this point, Yashoda Mai says to that ukhal, the mortar, you are also partner in crime. So you also need to be punished. So both she attempted to bind with that rope. So therefore, sthitagraiva damodaram bhakti baddham. So this pastime is very, very important, because the uniqueness of this pastime is the Supreme Lord awaits judgment from no one in other incarnations. Krishna is guilty and his fate is in Mother Yashoda's hands. The knowledge of Krishna's godhood is covered. And therefore, as he is crying, Rudantam Muhur, what is Krishna shouting? Rohini, Rohini, where are you? If only you were here today, you would have stopped Yashodamai's injustice. He's crying out. And then by hearing that cry, the neighboring ladies came and laughed. And they asked Yashodamai, he did something in your house? So they were also a little bewildered, because previously when the gopis would complain to Yashodamai that Krishna is a thief and he has stolen butter, she would actually defend. And now this time they saw Yashodamai is proactively punishing Krishna. So they were very surprised. And it is said that previously no one could actually even try to bind Krishna, because previously one gopi, when she attempted to bind Krishna, Krishna tied her up. And she became completely tied up. And then Krishna, after tying up, says, this is how you should tie me up. So if you don't know, learn from me. So nobody could actually attempt to do that. And so Yashodamai tied up Krishna with the cords of her strong prema. That Supreme Lord who binds the entire universe by the power of his maya. And therefore, Krishna na purvam na pichaparam na chantar na bahirchasya na purvam na pichaparam purva param bahirchantar jagato yo jagachayat. Why Krishna cannot be bound? Because he is all pervading in space. He is all pervading in time. And therefore, time has no limit, no before and after. You know, he is the universe, result of his Shakti. And therefore, because he is all pervading in space and time, how can he be bound? So how did Yashodamai want to measure him and bind him? It was only based on Yashodamai's love. Yashodamai could bind Krishna, who is the cause of everything. Atmajam matva, thinking him as her son, bound by parental love. Avyaktam, being controlled by love, all of his other powers were under control. Therefore, prakritam yatha, Yashodamai bound Krishna as if he was an ordinary boy. He cannot be seen by anyone, he is avyakta. Only Yashodamai can actually see Krishna's super excellent qualities. And therefore, it is described, Krishna has all the qualities and their opposites also. He has perfection of form while being formless. He has no color but bluish complexioned. He is smaller than the smallest but bigger than the biggest. He is controller of everything but yet controlled by devotees. He is within everything, but yet apart from everything. He is constantly all-pervading, but still he is localized. Although he is a small boy, but he is, through his Vibhuta Shakti, all-powerful. Therefore, Lord is beyond inconceivable and conceivable, spiritual and material, fierce and gentle, courageous and cowardly, great and small, pervading and not pervading, fiery and not fiery. He has his face everywhere and nowhere. This is described in the Narasimha Tapani Upanishad. And therefore, all the ropes were two fingers short, and she did not see his grandeur. She thought of him as a son. Like that. So how all of this happened? Out of the Achintya Shakti of the Lord. Like that. So therefore, so far, the Vibhuti Shakti of the Lord was, the Vibhuta Shakti of the Lord was prominent. Because when Yashodamai took up the rope to bind Krishna, so Krishna's Leela Shakti saw that, oh, if Krishna gets bound, how will the Leela of playing with the cowherd boys happen? How will the Leela of killing the demons happen? I cannot allow this rope to bind my Lord. So the Leela Shakti immediately gave instruction to Vibhuta Shakti that make sure that the binding does not happen. So the Vibhuta Shakti became activated, and the Vibhuta Shakti would not allow that rope to be bound around Krishna. And therefore, as that rope could not be bound, Yashodamai continued struggling, continued striving. And it is described that in spite of all of her efforts, Swamatu Svinnagatraya Visrishta Kabarasraja Drishtva Parishramam Krishna Kripayasit Swabandhane. Drishtva Parishramam. Krishna saw Yashodamai's repeated efforts. That yes, she is not becoming discouraged with one failure. She is trying again. She is trying again. She is repeatedly trying. And therefore, Yashodamai saw that Krishna's waist is not growing and the rope is not shortening. Still it is two fingers too short. So therefore, it is the Achintya Shakti of the Lord. So, in a choked voice, Krishna spoke some rich, sweet words. Krishna cried in a gentle, honey-sweet voice. As Krishna was crying, all the other cowherd boys, they were also crying. So Yashodamai's heart was palpitating with heavy breathing. She was perspiring, tired, overwhelmed. And all the other gopis, they looked at Yashodamai and said, actually, looks like due to Krishna's good fortune, he may not be able to be tied. Listen, Yashoda, give up this attempt. Forget this effort to try to bind Krishna. So when we try to bring Krishna, when we try to bind Krishna within our mind, sometimes the effort may take a long time. And the effort may take so long and so difficult that we ourselves may start thinking it is not possible to do it. And others may say it is not possible. And they may even question, why you came to Krishna consciousness so early? We told you, enjoy life. So therefore, drishtva pari shramam. Shrama means effort. Pari means 360 degree. From all angles, the effort must be made. So the village women advised Yashodamai. Yashodamai was insistent. What is that parishramam which attracted Krishna? Even if evening comes, even if all the ropes in the entire village are exhausted, I must find out the extent of Krishna's waist. I will not give up my effort. So therefore, that was her stubbornness. And so that is described here. And what is that? There is this constant battle going on between the Lord and the devotee. And Chakravarti Pad explains, in the competition between the Lord and the devotee's stubbornness will prevail. So the devotee must continue to be stubborn. So the Lord gave up his own stubbornness, and by his own mercy, Kripa, Krishna allowed himself to be bound. So when Krishna saw that Yashodamai is becoming tired, so Krishna turns towards Kripa Shakti. So Kripa Shakti is always resting peacefully, because she gets activated only when Krishna directly instructs. So when Krishna turns to Kripa Shakti and says, you now defeat this Vibhuta Shakti. So when Kripa Shakti, she is the Kripa Maharani, she is the queen of all the Shaktis. When she got up, all the other Shaktis withdrew. And then Yashodamai was successful in binding Krishna. So therefore, this, you know, beautiful pastime demonstrates that in the constant competition between the devotee and Krishna, devotee making his effort to bind Krishna within his heart, that effort has to be consistent, has to be constant, has to be intense. The purity has to be, you know, extremely powerful. Only with that intention and intensity, we will be able to actually bind Krishna within our heart. Nirvikara horidasa gambhira ashay bolite lagila tore hoya sadai. So our determination to practice bhakti will depend on the purity of our intention. So no, nothing could distract Thakur Haridas because he was nirvikara, gambhira ashay. His intention was deep. So similarly, Yashoda Mai's intention to serve and bind Krishna was so deep that no amount of discomfort could prevent Yashoda Mai from trying to bind Krishna. And ultimately, she was successful, and that is exactly what Shukadeva Goswami wants to prove through this pastime. Evam sandarshita yanga harina bhritya vashyata svavashena api krishnena yasyedam seshwaram vashe. So, evam sandarshita, to demonstrate this, Shukadeva Goswami says, Krishna performed the Damodar Lila. To demonstrate what? To demonstrate, number one, how Atmaram became Stanyakam. Second, how Purna Manorath becomes Atripta. Third, how Vishuddha Sattva Vigraha can develop Krodha. Fourth, how the Lord who can instill fear within Mahakal and Yamaraj can become fearful. Fifth, Lord whom even the yogis cannot catch, how he is caught by Mother Yashoda. Sixth, how the eternally blissful Lord is crying. Seventh, how the supreme controller who is binding everyone in this creation is forcibly bound by Mother Yashoda. Okay. And in this way, all of these contradictions are very confidential. Full of desires dissatisfied, form of pure goodness angry, master of Lakshmi is stealing, instill fear through time and death, flees in fear, travels quickly on the vehicle of the mind, is caught by the grasp of Mother Yashoda. One whose condensed bliss is crying in fear, and all pervading is limited and bound by being tied up. And therefore, it is described that this particular pastime is demonstrated to reconcile all the contradictions, because those contradictions are reconciled by Krishna's one quality, kripa, bhakta anugraha. So if unlimited qualities of Krishna are there, but if the kripa or bhakta anugraha is not considered, then all of those other qualities will not give pleasure. Therefore, Lord is covered by His Kripa Shakti. The mercy shown to a devotee has to be the same proportion as the devotee's devotion to the Lord. So therefore, Krishna is bound to reciprocate with His devotee to the degree of His devotee's love. By devotee's control, His glory is increased. So what does this pastime indicate? Evam sandarshita hi anga harina bhritya vashyata. So do not think that my money is not in my control, health is not in my control, property is not in my control. My intensity to serve and please Krishna is in my control. Increase that intensity. When you increase that intensity, Krishna has to reciprocate. Bhritya vashyata. So therefore, yes, as we began today's class by saying we have to work hard. Everyone works hard. But what does the Braj pastime and what does the Vrindavan Leela and what does Damodar Leela indicate? If you have to work hard, work hard on increasing the intensity of your intention to please Krishna. Work hard on improving the consistency of devotional service. And then all of these apparent contradictions are reconciled and Krishna comes within the control of the devotee's love. The mercy produces all other qualities and counters all fault. Therefore, this mercy is the chief quality. Therefore, you know, this particular pastime is actually indicating the glory of Mother Yashoda. That yes, that Mother Yashoda is an eternally liberated Nemam Virincho Namabho Nashir Apyanga Samshraya Prasade Lebhire Gopi Yattat Prapya Vimuktidad. Yes, dear Parikshit, towards the end of 8th chapter, I mentioned that by Drona and Dhara performing their austerity, they became Yashodamai Nanda Maharaj. But no, that is not the real thing. The real thing is that Yashodamai and Nanda Maharaj are so unlimitedly exalted that Drona and Dhara are simply their small parts and parcels. So therefore, the true answer is presented in this verse. Nemam virincho na bhavo na shrir api anga samshraya prasade lebhire gopi yattat prapya vimukti. The exceptional devotion of Yashodamai amongst all the devotees, that exceptional devotion of Yashodamai brought Krishna under her exceptional control. So compared to Lakshmi, was very, very close to the Lord Vishnu, intense love for the Lord, yet what is Lakshmi's love? My Lord, I am yours. I belong to you. What is Yashodamai's love? Her mamata is independent. Krishna is mine. He knows nothing except me. I am his only shelter. Therefore, it is my duty to take care of him. That is Yashodamai's love. Second, Lakshmi Devi's mamata is mixed with Aishwarya. Yashodamai's concern for Krishna's welfare is more prominent. It is more possessiveness. She is not aware of Krishna's Aishwarya. Lakshmi Devi's mamata or possessiveness is dependent on Krishna's position as Lord. Whereas Yashodamai has no understanding of that Aishwarya. She is only concerned with Krishna's welfare and therefore she is also open to bind and chastise Krishna. Therefore, Krishna is more merciful towards Yashodamai. So therefore, that Brahma, that mercy was not given to Brahma, who is the Adi Kavi, not given to Shiva, who is the topmost Vaishnava, not given to Lakshmi, who is constant companion. Nemam virincho na bhavo na shrir api anga samshraya prasade lebhire gopi yattat prapya vi muktidat. And therefore, this is a very, very important point that Yashodamai is the Nitya Siddha, not Sadhana Siddha. The prema of Yashoda cannot be attained as a result of Brahmaji's boon, because Brahmaji is also praying to become blade of grass in Braj. Brahmaji is indeed counted in a much less class. So therefore, O Parikshit, though you know about Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj who are famous in scriptures as Nitya Siddha, in answer to your casual question about Nanda Maharaj and Yashodamai's austerities in the previous lives, which he asked in 8th chapter, 46th verse, Shukadeva Goswami says, I told the story of Drona and Dhara, who are only their very, very small parts and parcels. And therefore, that is not the real thing. Yashodamai and Nanda Maharaj are actually eternally liberated, exalted personalities. So in this way, this beautiful Damodar Leela has been enacted so that we can meditate on this pastime for the entire month of Kartik. Janmashtami and Radhashtami, Gaur Purnima are held on one day only, whereas Damodarashtakam is sung and this pastime is meditated upon and celebrated all through the month, so that we get the faith and conviction that there is only one thing which stops us from coming closer to Krishna: our own intense effort to try to bring Krishna within our heart. And even if our efforts fail, and even if it appears that we are slipping and falling, just like Mother Yashoda, we should not give up, but we should try again and again and again. There is one thing which is not limited at all: the extent of our efforts. So there can be no limit to the extent of our efforts, and we should go on making those efforts to try to ultimately attract Krishna within the core of our heart. So Nayam Sukhapo Bhagavan Dehi Nam Gopika Suta Jnani Nam Chatma Bhuta Nam Yatha Bhakti Matam Iha. Jnanis, yogis, karmis, they cannot bind Krishna. But the best amongst all Krishna's form is Gopika Suta, as Nandanandan, Yashodanandan. So let us, you know, on this occasion of the month of Damodar, be very conscious about the benefits which this particular pastime bestows upon us by helping us meditate on our ultimate goal and move in this direction by praying at the lotus feet of Srimati Yashoda Mai and Lord Damodar. Jai Shri Shri Radha Damodar Bhagwan Ki, Shri Shri Yashoda Damodar Bhagwan Ki, Damodar Ashtakam Ki, Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki, Itai Gaur Premanande. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna.